Hey everybody, it's Board Game Blogger here at the Haunted Game Cafe in beautiful Fort Collins, Colorado. As you can see behind me, Haunted Game Cafe has a great games library selection. You can come in, play a couple of games, have coffee, chat with the people here. It's great. Today we're going to review Downfall of Pompeii. It's a quick, light game, plays in about 45 minutes. It's really neat because there's two main sections. First, there's the worker placement section, basically, where you populate the city, and then the mechanics of the game completely change as you try and run the citizenry out of the city. It's pretty neat. It's pretty cutthroat. It's rule book. It's nice. It's in color. Pretty good examples and explanations of how the game plays. I think it's great for families, great for adults. There's not a ton of depth to the game, so if you're only looking for a deep strategic game, you're probably going to have to look elsewhere. But it's quick, it's light, it's good for what it is. Why don't we take a closer look at how... Okay, so here's the setup of an average three-player game. One of the interesting things about this, which I'm not a huge fan of, is the fact that the token colors are limited. So it scales based on the gameplay. So basically, in a two-player game, you have to play with red and black. They've only limited the number of tokens for that, and it just scales that way. So it's kind of odd. I haven't seen that in other games, but it's not a big deal. You know, unless you always want to play with blue or something, you can't play with blue in just a two-player game. So here's, say, the beginning of the board. We've taken some time to play the cards. The idea is you would play a card. Let's say you play the 11 card. Before, at the very beginning of stage of the game, all you get to do is place someone there. So we would place in the 11 building and then draw a card. After the first AD 79, pops up, then the game mechanics change a little bit, and when you play a card, let's say we played an 11 here for the 11 building. Because the first AD 79 has already triggered, we now get to place our person and then relatives based on how many people are already in the building. Since there's already two in this section of the building, I'd get to place two more workers, basically. So here and here. And then you draw back another card from the deck. So you're always having four cards in your hand, and they just have various building numbers. And sometimes you can draw an omen card, which lets you kick out one of your opposing players' workers into the volcano. So the strategy comes in by trying to set up the buildings. So you want to make sure there's enough people in a building that when you play, say, an 11 card, you can maximize the value off that and place the most total workers. Because after the first AD 79 card triggers, you can accelerate the population by placing more relatives. Also, locations on the board here. See these gray discolored squares? That's where the lava starts once the game changes phase. So let's say we've been playing for a while, and pretend the board becomes populated. Once the second AD 79 card triggers, then we're done with the cards. And now we start running our citizens out of the city. And the way they move is each turn, each player draws a lava tile, places it adjacent to where there's currently a tile, a lava tile of the same square. So this one, you know, is the mask, here's the column. And we take turns placing the lava squares. After the first lava square is placed, you then move two workers. And the speed of the worker is how many citizens are already within the square. So here there's two citizens. So this guy can move one, two, and run out the gate. Now, because there's only one left, I can only move one spot. So we're limited in that sense. So it's neat how the mechanics of the game so radically change. Initially, when you're filling up the city of Pompeii, It's based on playing the cards, and you're trying to strategically maximize both the location of your citizens that is closest to the gate and have the most citizens in the city available for play. And you play that off the relative's card. So that's a very neat aspect. And then the game changes so drastically with the tiles of lava. So here, let's say I drew a mask lava. Now that's in play. So the next time, if the next mask lava is drawn, it can either go here, here, or here on the board. And so you try and cut off your opponent's citizens fleeing the game. It's really quick, it's light. There's enough strategy, there's enough strategic decisions to make that it makes the game interesting enough to play. However, you know, there's not a huge lot of depth, and which is good. If sometimes you play with people who suffer from analysis paralysis, that's not going to happen here. It's not a big brain-burning game, but there's enough thought to make each choice interesting. Each game's going to be varied, and it's a lot of fun. I would recommend it if you think this is something you would like. Till next time, have fun gaming.